So I'm representing Finnish Mondial. It's a partnership. So you talked about engagement. Now, engagement is in our DNA. So I'm representing three organizations. One is Waste from the Netherlands. Other one is Aqua for All from the Netherlands. Third one is AMRE Flying Doctors. All three are based in the Netherlands, but we are not very active there. So Finnish Mondial, as I said, it's an acronym. Financial inclusion improves sanitation and health. And normally I would talk about what we do and how we do it, but I've been asked to talk about four or five things primarily. One is maybe, Adele, you can go to the next. And the next. Yeah. So I've been asked the following. Why even work in India? Why bother to partner in India? That was really the question I had. Then why partner with RDO Trust? Why are international partnerships needed at all? What do you look for in international partners? And what's in it for Netherlands or Waste? So why bother to partner in India? Well, as Waste, we've been there for over 30 years. Actually, Mr. Suburaman, we've been working with also for quite some time. RDO has been a long-term partner, and we had many, many more. But when we started with this Finnish program, the Finnish approach in 2009, India was one of the countries with the highest open defecation rate in the world. And another thing why we are interested in India, it's a country where you easily can innovate, where you can do things and then bring it to scale. Scale itself is quite often seen as an innovation, but doing things at scale also helps you to do your business differently. And you are thinking about back office support costs, you're thinking about transaction costs, turnaround times, using all these things which come from regular business. That's something which you work, when you work on skill, you can start thinking about these things and acting to it. So we've done a pretty large program in India together with all our partners, a 200 million euro program, and that we took 10 years to do it. And now we want to do a 400 million program in 5 years. Next, please. So RDO Trust, why? Well, it's a 10 year of partnership. So we have a history together, and it's a really a strong grassroots organization. They have excellent context also with the government, particularly, but with the people. They have a good management and they're very much willing to innovate. So the thing we're talking about here is what Rajkumar, so I won't go into details on the pictures. He'll be talking about it. Next, please. So why are international partnerships needed? For me, always innovation starts when you have different organizations, different minds coming together. It doesn't start. There are too few Einsteins in this world. There are a couple of Newtons, but they are far in between. Most of the time, it happens when like-minded people meet and they talk and discuss and maybe come up with new ideas. We do have access to a lot of best international practices. We are always looking for new ideas. Exchange is very important in this whole context. We do bring in multiple sources of expertise, but also financing. If I told you the acronym stands for financial inclusion, so we work a lot on financing streams. And we have done 1 million household toilets in sanitation systems. Sorry, I shouldn't use the word toilets in India in the last 10 years. And that has been reaching out to 5 million people. And in addition, many other things, many other benefits have materialized in terms of working days, in terms of gender equality, etc. Next. So this is the way we operate, but I'll leave that for you to read it at leisure. Next, please. So what do we look for in international partners? It depends really on the type of partner. For NGOs, we start looking for different things than we look for when we deal with businesses or with governments. So NGOs, the first and foremost, it has to have the partner, potential partner needs to have a like-minded mission and vision. Yeah, unfortunately, no, I skipped the previous slide, but that's the diamond slide. So we talk, basically, we have four sides of what we call the diamond. We work with communities, which is on top. Thanks, Adele. Then we work the business side, the financial institutions, and the government. And mostly our NGO partners are good at one or two things, not at everything. And we don't want them to be good at everything because everyone has their niche. So some partners are good in working with government. NGOs are typically good in working with communities. And then we have others for working with businesses and financial institutions. So for the businesses, we are, we really need to have an agreement on the vision, the business rollout. So what are their plans? Are they aligned with ours? And for those who are in the financial service industry, the same thing applies. With governments, again, it's a lot about vision and mission. It needs to, what we want to do needs to fit the government vision. It's never the other way around, of course. The government has an idea, they want to go somewhere and can be fit in their overarching scheme of things. India, of course, a very clear example. India, the Indian government came with Swachh Bharat mission and that our program fitted that very well. So we could tweak our program, twist our program in the Indian government program. So what's in it for the Netherlands or for waste? Why are we doing these things? Well, as the Netherlands, as the Dutch government have made a commitment to the SDGs. The Dutch commitment is 50 million people with safe sanitation by 2030. We have expertise in and particularly in innovation financing for SDG 6. We do have a number of best practice, or we do have access to best practices, joint capacity development. We are working together in the Netherlands. It's you need to work together. As most of you know, we're below sea level. If we don't work together, our dikes would collapse. That's from the historical part. And we would simply drown. So it's an absolute necessity that we work together. That's simply in our DNA. Fecal sludge development, that's something we have been from the core of our program, from the word go. And something where I'm personally very interested in, and we're still at the beginning, is reverse engineering. Working to scale, working on these sort of elements, the data we're going to collect, the information we're going to get, we think we can also do something in the financial services industry in the Netherlands, to give an example. And so these are our ambitions. What I mentioned, it's a big program. It's covering six countries. And I think I should stop here because I don't want to eat in Rajkumar's time. Thank you.
Please, yes.
Okay. I like what you just presented. I'm from Nigeria. And you know, Nigeria has over 200 million people. It's the largest black race in Africa. And as you've seen now, if you followed our presentation before this one, where over 40 something million people in Nigeria still practice OD. And actually, I'm a cooperative farmer. I have a cooperative in my local government registered in my state. And also, I'm one of the person representing the cooperative council in my local government. You see, what you've just presented is going to help Nigerians. And I don't know, we have a lot of resources based on the physics that is used as a material. Now I want to know, is there any how you guys send your company to Nigeria so that we start working to make these things work for us all over the world? And also, I can't like a liquid organic fertilizer too. Can it be extracted from this physics too? Can you have something like liquid organic fertilizer from this? Because we've been using other organic fertilizers, I don't want to mention any of them. We've been using it in the field, and then I believe this compost manure from the physicists can help us. We have a lot, very large resources. So I want to know, is anyhow it's going to work in Nigeria? I know it's going to work, but can you extend this to Nigeria so that we start production and then get government connected with this as a member of WASHCOM? We can make this work. And from here, we can also export to other countries.
What Rajkumar described was, now he's making co-compost. And co-compost is not a fertilizer, it's a compost. So it's a soil conditioner. It has an advantage over regular compost that it contains more nutrients. That's some of the properties of a fertilizer. We have it now as a product which is really similar to compost. It feels like compost. I think we're there now at that stage, right, Rajkumar? It used to be a little dry, but now it should be better, I think. But to make a liquid fertilizer, you talk about something else. That would be more like taking the urine separately, like what they do from South Africa. So that is really like liquid fertilizer. We're not doing that. That you can make from urine. Here's a combination of fecal matter and urine and wash water and everything that goes into a treatment plant, is dried there, taken out, and then processed together with organic solid waste. So that's what we have. Yes, that you can use it in Nigeria, there's no doubt about it. And this is not rocket science, fortunately. It is something which is very much replicable, I would say. The crux of the matter is you need to have farmers, you need to have clients, you need to think like a business. So you're making a product out of waste. And the I think one of the earlier questions already on now, how is this, how are people going to respond to it from Kenya? So we're setting up a similar plant in Kenya as well, and we're going to face exactly the same question. How this is going to be addressed in Kenya, I'm not really sure, but we'll see it when we get there. First, we make the product. When people see the product, they start thinking, okay, well, this is actually not what I suspected it to be. It smells very nice. It feels very nice. And actually, when you apply it to the soil, the plants actually like it. And the soil likes it. And that's important because we have degraded soils everywhere. And this is really what is quite critical in the whole climate discussion we're having globally. We find that soils, when they are degrading, they cannot hold water very well. So healthy soils can hold much more water and require less chemical fertilizer. So there's a big advantage if this can be applied. What is the interesting part from what Rajkumar said? These are small plants. These are not very costly plants. And the reason why it's there, you don't want to transport waste or the bulky compost over very long distances. So by nature, this will be small in size. But then since we would like to do things at a bigger scale, we just replicate the same thing over and over and over again. And then you also get skill. I'm not sure I've answered your question 100%, but I tried.
Very high contact with the Ministry of Agriculture, both in my state and above. So if this can come to Nigeria, and then I'll be proud that attending this meeting that I've brought something great to my country as well, looking at the business aspect of it. I know it's going to work. So maybe after this, we'll start chatting on how to make it work in Nigeria. I really have been working with the Minister of Agriculture, the commissioners, the government of my state. No, I'm existing because I have one of the largest, most active cooperative in my state. You understand?
This is
so lovely. All the best. Thank you. That was this lovely.
And I'll give everybody your email and all that. Valentin, I was fascinated by your statement about reverse engineering. So I was kind of wondering how the experience in developing countries can yield something for Europe.
Okay, actually, I can combine the two. So reverse engineering, as you know, you cannot do this in Europe. It's not allowed. The EU has banned use of human waste in agriculture. So trying this out in other countries, and then because this is a policy decision, which is based on something which they thought at that time was the right thing, but policies can also be changed. But we need compelling evidence. Now, if you can't change we can't bring out the evidence in Europe because we're not allowed to. We can't do it even on a pilot basis. So how does the reverse engineering, in my view, works? If we can show in other countries that it's absolutely safe and it does contribute to a better soil, it does contribute to improved agricultural practices, it does improve to a better carbon footprint of agriculture, then we can bring that back to Europe and start a discussion there. It won't work very well, I must confess, in the Netherlands, because we are a nutrient-rich country. We have far too many cows and what we have, sheep and, not sheep so much, chicken and, pigs. So we have too much nutrients ourselves. So Holland is a nutrient surplus. But there are other parts of Europe, Spain, France, where it should certainly be feasible to do it. So that's one part of reverse engineering. The other part, it's more like that's very advanced financial engineering. So I just leave that to it.
That's fair enough, because I know that the financial engineering is also very, very important. And it is